My name is Demeter Sztanko. People call me Dimi. I'm actually a big data architect or whatever you call it, and a company called Badoo. Actually, we are hiring just a person for me to work with me. So if you will like me, then just feel free to contact me and we'll talk about this. Anyway, and I do geo just for fun and for leisure. These kind of my weekend projects. And so I do mostly interesting stuff is OpenStreetMap, and my furry topic is some kind of shortest or nicest path finding, so things like this. Also, I think this weekend is going to be the summer solstice weekend. You're encouraged to go and have a look at my website, which is basically a collection of all the streets aligned towards the sunrise of the sun when it's summer solstice. It's stupid. A project which has nothing to do with money, it's just fun. Yeah. So I'm going to talk about how to analyze geospatial data in Python. First of all, I would like really to apologize that my IPython notebook is not really, probably not up to standards, because I'm not a data analyst or data scientist. The other thing is it's really complicated to install this kind of stuff, so you might not be able to get through all the packages until the end of this tutorial. So I promise that on this weekend I will publish some kind of tutorials on how to install things. I wanted to do this before this, but it was really complicated to do this. Yeah. So. If you actually have Python here installed, and if you can install these three packages, at least the first one, that will be great. That will probably cover like 80% of this tutorial. Fiona it's a nice package as well. And Artry is actually not a mandatory thing, so it's not a blocker. And again, the QGIS is a toolkit for viewing stuff. And it's I highly encourage you just to keep it. If you ever will be working with geodata, probably the first thing you will need is QGIS before you start into any kind of analysis. It's really nice for viewing and analyzing different kinds of data. Also, I'd like to say that it's not going to be entirely Python. I mostly will be talking about generic concepts of geospatial terminology, and some of the things actually they can be done much better in some other tools like GDAL or in Node.js and things like that. Is there any reason it's gone down? Can it happen because I'm not in the power?
It's not extended. No, I don't
know. Just check this. Do it.
No, it's not my. I'm not with the venue, so I don't find someone who is.
Can you just ask Ian central basics, which are the types of geometries you can find, and it's obviously really, really trivial, and you probably know what is that about. It's basically all kinds of shapes we can imagine, points, lines, polygons, things like that. Now, geospatial industry is a very, very boring and precise one, and they created a specification for that. And in fact, there is a reason they did that, because there are many, many non-trivial questions in that. You will see this in the tutorial later. So I highly encourage you to familiarize yourself with this link once you will need to start working on this. So let me have a look. If you have access to this thing, you can open this and notebook.
There's no other way to get to that apart from your numbers, is that right?
Sorry, yes, unfortunately. I will try to find some way for that over the weekend. We'll see. First primitive or geometry primitive we have is point, and obviously it's a very, very simple thing. Some points they are two-dimensional, some points they're three-dimensional, indicating height. We're going to deal with two-dimensional points only. This will cover 99% of all the cases. And we also have lines. Well, we don't have lines in geospatial industry. We call them line strings, and it's a sequence of points. And they can be like self-intersecting, or self-closing, things like that. The only thing is that you should not have duplicate points in terms of the sequence of points should not be, points should not repeat one after each other, because otherwise it will be a, invalid geometry. Let's try to do this. Actually, I'm wondering what will happen. I think it will go through, but if we will ask for the geometry, whether it's valid, it will tell. It's not valid. No, it's still valid. Okay, weird. Anyway, I might be wrong, but I think it doesn't make sense to have a line string which repeats points. Now, the other thing. The other important constructive is a linear ring. It's basically a linear string which has start point and end point the same, and direction does not matter. Now, polygons, they are formed of linear rings. So polygon is actually a set of linear rings. First one is the outer shape, and the other ones, all the other ones are the holes inside. And now we kind of get a normal polygon, which looks like that. We have some other primitives like curves, three-dimensional spaces, things like that. We're not going to cover them because, first of all, it's really complicated to work with them. And second of all, you probably will almost never work with them unless you're dealing with some kind of 3D modeling, but you probably will not be on this tutorial then. So yeah, also you have like invalid polygons, which I'm mentioning just because if you will be working with geospatial data, you will probably encounter with lots of those. So all these open data sets, they are full of messy data, and just don't be freaked out if you see these kind of stuff. So Python libraries which are dealing with geometries, they have this primitive which is called... first of all, let's go and have a look at what kind of libraries we have. So we have a library called Shapely, which is a library for dealing with geospatial primitives, and they all represent all this kind of stuff we are talking about. This is just some code for drawing it. We will ignore this at this moment. And so every kind of geometry has a very simple bound of function. So like you have isValid, you can also have line isValid. Oops. And you can actually test for validity of different kind of stuff. So you also can have this kind of collections of primitives. So they all call the same as point string in polygon, but they are multi-point, multi-line string, and multi-polygon. And you will encounter lots of them. Actually, most of the things you will see, they're either points or they are multi-polygons. Things you can do with geometries, there are quite a few of those. So first of all, you can do some set tasks on this. So for example, you can union two different polygons or two different geometries, and then you will get something which is another geometry. So let's have a look. How does it look like? For example, let's have a Yeah, actually, also one of the things you can make you can transform every geometry into polygon via a buffer operation. So, like if for example we have a point, we can plot a point which will look like this. Right, what is this? And we also can plot a union of, oops, what's wrong with that? Union line. Right, it's a different, yeah, sorry, I can't do this. So, anyway, you can plot this stuff.
What's with the buffer? Why do you want to
buffer? Buffer is basically a operation which will convert any kind of geometry into multi-polygon. It basically gives a dimension to the to everything. So, for example, if you do a buffer on of a point, you will get this thing.
So it basically fills up the space.
Yes, it fills up the space. So you can specify like any kind of arbitrary value here. You also can specify a zero thing, which will make it a.
So that's why you couldn't do the union, because it needs to have like density to be able to do it.
Not really. Sometimes you could actually, I think you can actually create, it will be a geometry collection, which can consist of many different types of different dimensions. Yeah, but buffering always gives a second dimension to the stuff. So actually, let me. Sorry. Okay. Yeah, so you can have all kind of operations. I think they're still very, very trivial. You can always check whether different objects, they contain each other, overlap each other, touch each other, things like that. And all of this specification, all these operations is actually written down in this specification. So they have everything described in mathematical terms. So yeah, let's go back to the buffer operation. If you have like a geometry which you don't really know what is that, and you would like to start working with it, you basically apply a buffer to it, and it will transform into multi-polygon, which is something that you can handle. It's kind of familiar for you. So let's have a look. How would it look like? So let's suppose we have a point and a line, and we will union them and buffer them up, and then draw them. But this is how it looks like. Then also, what we can do, we can buffer this element once again. Let's do this, and then actually. Make a difference after the previous buffer and this one. Actually, I already have this thing. And what you'll get is this thing. So this is the way we can construct things. The easiest way of actually construct a circle is put a point and make a buffer of given radius around it, and you will get a let's give you an example. So if you want to make a circle with radius 10, you just put a point and say buffer 10, and we've got a circle. That's very simple. Now, you can also simplify some geometries. In this case, it's not really important for us, but in case if you will be dealing with administrative boundaries, they usually have lots of points, and sometimes it's not really important to have such a big level of precision. We will be covering this later. I will be showing examples of this. But it is very simple to simplify a geometry. This means basically to reduce the number of points which are needed here without very significant loss of precision. There are special algorithms for this which optimize the precision loss, and basically the way you're doing it is you're simplifying and you're telling how big the precision threshold should be. The larger the threshold is, the less accurate things are going to be. Yeah, let's look at this. This is now a very inaccurate thing. And again, vice versa. If you specify a smaller buffer, you probably would not even notice too many things. You actually still can notice, but it's not that big thing. Now, the other operation you probably will need sometimes is the convex hull. Convex hull is, do you know what convex polygon is? And basically, it will try to find the smallest area, so the convex polygon with smallest area, which will still can cover this stuff. And this is how it looks like, for example. So in our case, let's just remove all this stuff. And this is how it will look like for this. Sorry. Yeah, for this thing, this is the convex hull of it. Okay, it's also important to notice that if you do a buffer operation with positive value and then immediately do a buffer operation with negative same value, it will not return you the same object you started with. So if you have, let's have a look at this one. So if, let's suppose we have this element, and if we apply a buffer operation to this, obviously, the holes inside will disappear if we apply a large enough buffer. And then if we buffer it again with a negative same value, oops, this will be a totally different object. So bear that in mind. Actually, one of the mistakes some people do, this thing can lose information. Okay, so some other less frequently used operations you can have in Shapely is interpolation. It's basically if you've got a line string and you've got a so you would like to so this line string, for example, it contains of five points, and you would like to walk through this from 1 to 5, then you can actually say, like make a, this is called interpolation. So you calculate the position of a point which will be at step 1.2, which means it will be somewhere after the first point, somewhere here. Let us see. Come on. Oh, sorry.
It's getting in the line.
Yeah. All right, makes sense. Here we go. Yeah, thank you. So again, if you go to the 3, 4, it will be somewhere here. So I think you kind of get the idea of this. We also have a inverse to this. This is a projection. So if you have a point and you would like to find the part of the line string which is closest to that point, then you can use the project. Command. It's really, really simple to use, actually. It's nothing to do with this. Okay, so this is basically the basics, and we have to know that everything we will be working on, it's either polygon or it's multi-polygon, it's point or it's line string, and we can deal with these kind of stuff. So then let's go now, let's just switch to the to maps themselves. So the way we are going to represent, there are many, many ways of representing this geometry. So one of the simplest ones is it's really simple even to call it well-known text, and this is how it looks like. And if you want to get the well-known text of any kind of geometry, the way you will do this is actually, you just add a WKT at the end of it. So let's, for example, do So let's, for example, do the WKT of this element. And the value we'll be having to do is just print this dot WKT. And here we go. This is the data for this polygon. Please note that it actually is an array of arrays. And the outer array contains of one element. This is because, as we mentioned, it consists of linear rings. And the first linear ring is the shape. The other linear ring is all the others are the holes. Since we don't have any holes in this particular case, we wouldn't have anything here. If we actually decide to do, like, for example, a difference with let me plot this as well. Right. If you wanted to have the WKT of this one, it probably will have now two of these things. Yeah, here we go. You see, this is the second. This is the coordinates of the small hole we have inside. So yeah. And this is how you can construct really, really complex shapes just with the help of few commands. I think it's really, really simple. Apart from this, I would like to say that each of the some other things you can get with this is well-known binary, which is the binary representation of this thing. So it's obviously not human readable, but it takes much less space, and most of the toolkits, they understand this thing. So if you will ever need to save space, you can use this one. The other thing you can have is bounds, which is basically the bounding box of the geometry. We will be using it later. I will show it why it is important. And obviously, you always can test for validity. And obviously, in our case, it will be true. Yeah, it's valid. Right, so the other representation of geometry can be a shapefile, a GeoJSON. Which is basically the same WKT, but represented in JSON format. Do you know what JSON is? Mm-hmm. Anyone doesn't know what that? Great. So to be honest, the best will be if you just go to the spec and we have a look at this. Again, it's something that is super, super simple. The good thing about GeoJSON is also it contains not only geometries, but it also can contain properties of the geometries, which is really good. And if we combine a geometry with a property, then we call it a feature. And for example, in our case, we store a feature collection, which is a list of features. And each feature has properties and a geometry. And it always tells you what is this. This line string with this coordinates, this is a polygon with this coordinates, and so on and so on. It also has some other things like coordinate reference systems and things like that, which are not important at this moment. We will get back to them later. There is an optimized version of GeoJSON, which is called TopoJSON. It is a recently new format introduced around 3 years ago, and it seems like it can work only with JavaScript at this moment. Maybe there are some new toolkits for Python, but so it's still important to know them because there are some bindings for Python. For example, a library called Vincent, which is translating your data into a JavaScript format and then visualizes this using D3. And that actually accepts only TopoJSON, really, at the beginning. And the other thing, the reason it's really good, because when you're converting to TopoJSON, so this is the command how to install TopoJSON, you should have npm, which is a node package manager, which is a JavaScript thingy. I don't know, maybe on Windows there isn't some more user-friendly, not geek-friendly way of installing it, but actually I'm not aware of this. I'm a Mac user, unfortunately. And so it actually usually saves, from the beginning, it saves around 90% of space. But furthermore, when you're doing the conversion, you also can simplify. If you remember, this is what. Yeah, so you can do some simplification. Remember, we were talking about this, and with this you can save up much more space. I will be showing you some good numbers later on. It's included in this talk. Right, so one of the most frequent formats you will be finding on the internet is shapefile. It's a really old format. I think it was found in 92, and it still has this kind of really old Windows limitations, like you can't have a feature length name, so a property names, they cannot be longer than 12 characters, I think, or 8 characters. Also, it can contain only one set of properties. So if you have a look at GeoJSON I was showing just before, this feature collection actually is contained of line string and a polygon. And those properties, well, in this case, the property set is the same, but GeoJSON doesn't put any limitation there, so each property set can be different. Now, in shapefile, you can have only one type of geometry, so it's either line strings, or it's polygons, or it's points, or multipoints, or whatever, but it should be the same, and you also predefine the sets of properties you're going to have in the header of this file. It's a binary format, and usually you can find it on the internet in zipped variant. When you're unzipping it, I'll just show you how it looks like. You will usually see a shape file, then another SJX file, then you will have a projection file, and you will have a DBF file. And you will probably have a bunch of different other files which are not that important. But usually you have at least three files, so projection, shape file, and data. It might be a bit confusing in the beginning, but just ignore it and treat it as one thing. And the most important one is shapefile. I mean, it would not work without any other. So it will not work on it alone. But this is basically the main file. And when for example, in QGIS, when you're loading a shapefile, you have to look for the shape variant, not for anything else. Right. And the good thing about this is, sorry, actually, let me close it. Closing it, good. So the good thing about shapefile actually is that it can also contain spatial index. So that file with SHX extension is the index, which means that you can find a geometry, a given geometry, a geometry which can be located in some bounding box really, really easy without reading the whole file. And it's generally very, very fast to navigate and process these kind of files, file formats. This will make sense only if you're processing a shapefile which has more than 50,000 polygons, for example, and then you will realize, like, if you convert it from shapefile to GeoJSON, first of all, it will take much more space. Secondly, it will be much, much slower to load in any kind of programming language or any kind of toolkit or anything like that. Also, one of the bad things about it is that, for example, you can't really, so JavaScript doesn't really know how to read it. Node.js can, but JavaScript can't. So if you want to visualize it, you won't be able to use it. You will need to convert it. There is a very handy utility called Augur to Augur. So actually, you have to install a thing called GDAL. It's a set of libraries for geospatial processing, and I think one of those one of the commands you will get is Augur to Augur. I think it's cross-platform, so you're able to use it everywhere. And this is how you actually can convert between different formats. So actually, let me show you something. So this is a list of file formats you can understand, and yeah, you can, if you got point data or line string data, it can convert to JPEG, so you can do vice versa. So it's actually a kind of Swiss Army knife of geoformats. Yeah, so the way you can read shapefiles in Python is with this package called Fiona, and it's a very, very trivial package. That's actually everything you can imagine in Python. No, not this one. Here we go. So, for example, I think you should be able to. If you try, you would like to try it out on your laptop, you have to download this. I don't know how to copy it. Actually, if you go to my GitHub, you should be able to find this file, and you should be able to download this zip file, unzip it, convert it to JSON, and you'll be able to play with this. Actually, this is how it looks like. Yeah, actually, we're looking for this one. Sorry. So this is just an example. This is a data set which represents you the oldie wards in London, and this is how it looks like. Let me show you. Actually, I already have it here. So this is how it looks like. And you have different wards, and actually this is how you load it, and in Python. So you just input Fiona, you tell what the shapefile is, and you open this file with Fiona. And from now on, it behaves like a collection. So you can ask for lengths of it, you can convert it to list. Do this and then this. Actually, I don't know why it's not working. Maybe it's overloaded. Oh, here we go. Okay. Yeah, so you can actually ask for example, first item of it, and you will get the coordinates, and you will get the properties. It's represented as an ordered dict, but I think it's a Fiona feature. It actually has nothing to do with core shapefile features. And if you would notice that coordinates here in this case are really weird, so it's definitely not latitude and longitude. I will get back to this soon. It's actually a different reference system, but it's really simple to overcome, and actually you will love it at the end of this tutorial. So actually I've just transformed this this collection into a dictionary where you can refer each word by its name. And for example, the Bunhill, it's a word where we are located right now. This is how it looks like. Again. And we will get back to reference systems just in a minute. So in order to understand these numbers you just seen here in this output, we have to understand what is the coordinate reference system is, and how are things displayed on the Earth. You probably all know that Earth is actually a globe, it's not a plane, and it causes huge problems. And if I could vote this thing down, I would really do that, because it just causes too many problems in geospatial world. And when we want to show some map, we need to somehow project it on a plane, right? And you can't really project a globe to a plane without any kind of loss. So there are around 50 different methods of projecting things, and all of them, they are trade-offs between different kind of distortions. So if you want to categorize, there are different, basically three types of projections. So, wow, amazing. First is when you're trying to project on a plane. It's basically the simplest thing. It's let me actually try to show you an example of this. Right. Oh, that's no. This is probably a wrong example. So basically, this is how it looks like in theory. And all you have to know that if we go into this really little small circle, then there are almost no distortions. The further we go away, the bigger the distortion is. And depending on how we choose this kind of projection, how this will be. So distortions will be different types. The other way of projecting is when you're trying to project things on a cylinder. So we're trying to project in some objects, which then we can straighten out, and it will be really simple to put on a plane. So cylindrical is actually another projection which is very, very frequent. So the famous Google projection we can see when we go just maps Google is a cylindrical projection that's called Mercator. We will speak about this later. If we have some larger countries, like, for example, Russia, then we will see that this is a canonical projection of Russia. I think it's actually using their own projection. And this is a projection on a cone. This is how we usually project large countries, which spread over many, many meridians. The same thing is with United States. They have a special projection, which is called Arbutz, and it is the same thing. So it is really optimized for projecting on. So it's a conical projection, which is optimized for this part of the world, and in this part of the world, it gives you least distortion. Yeah. So we have different types of distortion. So in some cases, we will try to preserve the shape. For example, it's a Google Maps projection. So if you go to Google Maps, you will see everything. And you zoom in to a city level, everything will seem normal. So there will be no distortions. Whereas if you, for example, go to like try to use again this azimuthal projection, it will get distorted in some parts of the world, like for example here. And it can be used in some very special use cases. So for example, this is a ad of Iceland Air. And so usually if you have a look at Google Maps, and Iceland is tucked up somewhere in north, and it's not really close to anything. But if we actually put a projection which preserves distances, then we will see that, and we center it in Iceland, that we actually can kind of see that it's located on the midway of all the airplane passes. And actually, if you fly to western states, you probably will be flying over Iceland. This is true. So this is actually a very good advertisement where they really they're using projection in a really, really good way. So it can actually change the way you are. You can see the country. The simplest projection you can never think, it's a deep, dirty and simple one. It's plate carré. I think it's called plate carré in French. I don't know. I was asking my colleague today, who's French, and this is what he said. And it's basically when you're trying to be lazy and you use your latitude as y coordinate and longitude as x coordinate, and this is how it looks like. You probably can see it on some airplane screens when you're flying from one point to another, and it gives you some distortions. But another way, the good thing about it, it's really, really simple to make it. It doesn't require any kind of try geometrical transformations. And also, one thing which is not trivial, I mean, we never thought about it. Basically, it gives you a very good, accurate understanding of how far away from the North Pole each element of the map is. So basically, the Y coordinates also can be used as an indicator of distance from the North Pole, which is useless in our case. But if we try to rotate the Earth and, for example, center it over London, then this is what we will get. Right? And yeah, this is, I think this is London. And this map will kind of tell us how far away each part of the world is from London in kilometers. Right, this is one of those examples. Still looks really weird and ugly, but it actually, I'm just trying to show why it can be useful in some cases. In case if you actually would like to measure some distance, then this projection, which is called azimuthal, which I was already mentioning, it can give you much better understanding of things. So this is London, it's centered in London, and it gives you an accurate distance from the center. Obviously, you can see that shapes are really, really distorted, but we don't really care about this case. If for example, we would like to visualize some flights and distances. One of the use case of this was when the Malaysia airplane has disappeared in Southeast Asia. Then lots of newspapers were trying to find some nice map about that. And I think almost all of them, they failed with projection. So I think actually this map was, this visualization was actually created to help newspapers to show how to utilize map projection for to make some use of it. So actually, yeah, they could just draw some circle around a part where Malaysian Airlines flight has disappeared and show it. Another projection you probably have seen is Mercator, and this is what Google Maps is using. And basically, it had two highlights in its life. It's when it was invented, because it was a very useful thing for navigation and with ships, and when Google Maps come out. So here, it's a cylindrical projection, and we're trying to project a the whole world on a cylinder, which is kind of located somewhere here. And things that are North Pole and South Pole, they go into infinity. And things near equator, they are least distorted. Now, the problem with this is actually that things getting really, really distorted in the North and South Poles, and they're getting inaccurate. And that's why Greenland actually looks like so big. There's an interactive version of that shows you the problems and distortions that you can find with Mercator, and I hope it will load soon. So one of the things, for example, Greenland is 14 times smaller than Africa, but in Mercator projection, it will show actually it's the same thing. Let me, yeah. So this one is kind of the same as here. Come on. Okay, let's leave it a little bit later. From the navigational point of view for ships, it was really useful because if you go in straight line here, the compass will be always pointing to the same direction. And before the reliable clock was invented, before they could estimate the position of longitude, they really tried to use this kind of navigation, just going through some parallel. Maybe it's not the shortest route, but it's kind of the route that will get them somewhere. Yeah, here we go. It's actually loaded. So, for example, this is Iceland, and this is how. This is Australia, and this is how it will look like if it was north. And this is how small it is. And this is actually Greenland. And I think this is South Africa. So actually, yeah, it's a good way to see how huge countries in the Africa are compared actually to Europe. We don't really notice that before we just because we got used to Mercator projection. And this is Ukraine, which is really, really small here, but it gets bigger here. This is Mongolia. So anyway, just have fun with this game. It's really nice. And I can play it right now. So anyway, I think around 60s, some people realized that actually this map is not only inaccurate, but also it's kind of, so the countries which are larger, they're usually the Western countries and states, and the poor countries, they seem to be smaller, and it's politically incorrect, and it's not really good, so we need to find some kind of different projection which will be fair to all the nations, and they came out with Peter's projection, which is correct and fair, but it's ugly. And it is a equal area projection, which means that all the countries have same area, and it is true, but the shape is just distorted. So, actually there was a comedy sketch about this Peter's projection, which is back in the 70s. If you will get into it, you can Google it, Peter's projection, you'll find it. So, yeah, actually there are really, really lots of projections. So, unfortunately, Python is not that good in projecting stuff. So it still supports around 15 projections, but you actually have much more projections in D3 in a JavaScript toolkit it's for data visualization, but because one of the creators of this toolkit is a mathematical genius and he's really into maps, he created a lot of different projections which can be used for different kinds of life situations. So if you will have to map something, you will need to choose some kind of projection, and there is a very nice tutorial on how to choose the right projection. We're not going to go through this, but basically what it tells is that if your country is like England, so it's stretched into one direction, then just use a cylindrical projection. So for example, Britain's official projection is a Mercator projection, which is rotated around its axis towards Scotland. Let me see if we have anything like that. We don't have United Kingdom here, and it is pretty accurate for United Kingdom. It's really, really inaccurate for anything else, but for United Kingdom, it rocks. Same refers to Chile. Is it Peru? Chile. Same refers to Turkey. If, in case you've got some kind of square country like Brazil, then you will be using this azimuthal projection. And in case if your country is stretched along the longitudes, so it has multiple longitudes, then you probably should use a conic projection. So example of this is obviously Russia, or this is, I think, Kazakhstan or Mongolia. I don't know. I think it's Kazakhstan. Anyway, so I don't want to speak about this longer. There is a link. It explains things much better than me. So if you will ever bump into this kind of problem, just use this one. In case if you need to display the whole world, then there is a set of projections which are used for this. And they are more of a statistical nature. So these kind of projections of accurate family, they are very, very nice. And they are kind of a trade-off between distortion and beauty. Yeah, so I think you have to approach this kind of projections as fonts. So depending on the style of your presentation or whatever you're going to do, you have to choose different projections. They even things like this, which are really beautiful. Anyway, play with this. I can spend days watching projections, so but maybe I'm weird. Who knows? So going back to this strange coordinates we have encountered here. Not here. Here. This is because of the coordinate reference system, and all the shapefiles in England, I mean, at least all the official shapefiles which are coming from some kind of statistical authorities or from the government, they are encoded in OSGB 36 standard, which is using this kind of special Mercator projection rotated towards the axis of UK, and it uses meters instead of latitude and longitude. So if you have a map, then you need to know three things. So first of all is shape of the Earth, which sounds really trivial for us. It's like a globe, right? It's not really it's not really a globe. It's not a circle. It's a really complicated thing. And I will just give you an example. So this is actually if we try to exaggerate, this is how our Earth looks like. So we've got a bump here, which is around 80 meters higher than here. And it's really difficult to actually estimate some accurate coordinates if you actually will assume that the whole Earth is, say, ellipsoid, was almost same height and width. There were some problems during the Second World War and First World War when the coordinates of different battles in Europe, they were calculated using different assumptions of the shape of the Earth, and that's why now it's really difficult to recreate the historical locations of the battles. And after the Second World War, actually, the European Commission decided to use one. Since that time, the accuracy of the Earth has measurements of the Earth's radius have improved, and they have introduced another standard for the shape of the Earth. And we will be talking about this later. Actually, I would like to say that United Kingdom official shape of the Earth standard is coming from 19th century, so they haven't switched to the new one, and we're still living in the old Earth. But it's actually pretty accurate for this part of the world. So yeah, it makes sense because here the bump is much higher, and you get more accurate coordinates if you're talking about England. So the other thing when you have a data set is you want to know the location of the zero coordinates. So let's suppose in England, let me find a map of England. Oh, actually, sorry, UK. So this is how usually United Kingdom looks like. And if we want to kind of put it on a coordinate plane with X and Y, which will be like in meters, then your starting point will be somewhere here. Actually, it's here. And this will guarantee you to cover everything, including Northern Ireland and Guernsey and Shetland Islands as well. So I think our datum, the United Kingdom datum is actually the zero coordinate, just German in geospatial terminology. It's located somewhere here, and if we have a look at these numbers, you will actually realize that they are expressing the number of meters on this coordinate plane from that origin point. So it is 532 kilometers east and 181 kilometer north from that imaginary point, which is a bit south from Isles of Scilly. So this is how it looks like. Actually, you are able to create your own projections. I will show you later how to do this. So today we will be creating our own reference system, which sets its origin as the cafe here in the Finsbury Square, and we will be calculating everything from that point. So in order to transform one coordinate reference system to another one, there is a package called PyProj. Actually, it's a port of a different project, which is called Proj. And you can find this kind of package in all different languages, including JavaScript, Java, Python, C, whatever, anything else. So there are some projections which are the standard ones. Like one of them is OSGB36. You can actually, there's in a Wikipedia page about that. The other one is EPSG4326. If you're getting really good at reference systems, you can memorize them by heart. So I think EPSG 4326 is, actually, if you Google it, there is a website which gives you all, oh my God. I think I don't have internet, right? Can it happen? visualise too. Yeah, here we go. There's a website called Spatial Reference, which will give you all kinds of references, and there are thousands of them, actually. Yeah. Anyway, and the other one, which is called 2770, is the same as OSGB936. And it gives you all kind of information about this. And if you want to, all the information about this reference system is encoded in a special text string. And there are various formats of this. This is one of those things. It actually specifies the size of the ellipsoid. It specifies the location of the origin point. And it tells you that you're measuring things in meters. Where is that? Here we go. Unit is in meter. And also you're telling what kind of projection you're using. So this is Mercator, and you are scaling it and rotating it by some values. Anyway, hopefully you will never need to do this kind of stuff. It just, I want you not to be scared of these things if you see them. So PyProj actually understands all these numbers, and you can find them on the specialreference.com website. And Fiona, you can ask it for its reference, and this is how you say. So if you've got a C, which is the shapefile, if you ask to print coordinate reference system, right, let me do this once again. Here we go. And if you want to convert it to one of these kind of machine-readable strings, then there is a special function called toString, which will do this for us. And PyProj actually can understand this kind of strings, so this is why we're using it. So in our case, we will be transforming all the information of words, so all this kind of stuff, from this coordinates to, so this is like the normal coordinate reference system, which we think is the normal coordinate reference system. And you can actually use it in any, so it's a de facto standard right now. It's called WGS84, anyway. And if you actually transform it, then this is what you will get. Now the transformation step itself looks like this. So Shapely has a method called transform, which can do whatever transformation of every coordinate of a geometry. And in our case, we should specify a lambda function, which is like an anonymous function in Python, to transform from source projection, which is our projection, so this one, to destination projection, which is the de facto standard. And we just do it, and this is what we get. Okay, now I just wanted to show you one of his examples where this software is not really ideal. For example, in Mac, if I will try to check validity for one of the words after I have converted it, I think it will not even give you an example. Yeah, in our case, right, sorry, a shape I need to, sorry, I will translate it. Oh, here we go. This is what you will get. And I think it will work in Windows and in Unix systems, but with Mac it will fail anyway. So the other way of transforming, reprojecting things is actually you don't use any kind of Python. You just go to, let me see, where is that? So if you just go to command line and you just use this auger to auger, and you can specify target's reference system and source reference system. And you can use the same strings for that, and it will neatly and nicely reproject everything you need. So let me see if I have example for that. Yeah, here we go. So for example, here I'm. This is a command for converting the shapefile we're getting into JSON file, GeoJSON file, which will have normal coordinate system. So let me actually do this just for you. we'll wait a little bit and we'll do this. So what we'll have at the end is actually normal coordinates, which we already can use in QGIS. So if we load this JSON, then it will work normally, simply. Actually, I would like to say that QGIS also can natively understand all kind of reference systems, so you don't need to do this extra step, but you will need this step for visualizing these things in Python. So as I mentioned, the best, so actually this tutorial is not about visualizing data in Python, because I think there will be next tutorial which will be in the same room next after me. It's much better in that. So I was just trying to find some packages which will do this thing for you. And one of them is Vincent, which translates things into JavaScript and then shows it. And it accepts this topo.json format. And what you do is, well, you have to play with the scaling. So if I don't do the scale, it probably will. It probably will draw the whole Earth with small dot, which is London, so I will need to scale it. I was just playing around with numbers. This is how I came up with 40,000. I would like to center the map at this coordinate, which is, I think, the Finsbury Square. And if I do this, and this is how I will get it. Now, if you have a look at this, it's actually a very, very, very accurate shape, and in fact for our scale it's probably over accurate. If you have a look at the file size, file sizes, then our words JSON is actually 6.89 megabytes. If you will decide to convert it to topo JSON, so this is how we do this. So if you actually convert it without any kind of simplification, so there will be no data loss, then this is already reduced to 600 kilobytes. So it's much smaller, and we still have the same resolution. If I decide to start some simplification, remember this number is actually in degrees of the longitude. So I think it's called, yeah. So if I do this, and I will have a look at this size of this file, it will be actually only 100 kilobytes. And if we try to visualize it, so this is the accurate file, and this is the slightly simplified one. If you can see, actually, yeah, it doesn't have this kind of edges, so there is some information loss, but it's pretty much enough for us. And if we want to do some drastic simplification, so we just decrease the simplification factor, then this is what we get. Now you can see it's a bit oversimplified, but it's probably still very good for understanding this stuff. Yeah, it's actually very, very important when you're doing websites and you want to load some geographical data very fast. So topo.json is really good in this kind of sense. In our case, it's important only because I'm using this toolkit, which is probably the best for doing this. Vincent also supports pandas data frames, and you can actually create some really good cartograms with that, where each area will be showing different, will be colored in different way according to some attribute. But there are some tutorials on the internet how to do this, and I don't really know how to use pandas, so that's why I didn't include it. But we will be doing something very similar in a different way. So yeah, let's go back to our tutorial. Yeah, so I just showed, I just have a look at these tutorials. They explain you how to do this kind of stuff. And I would like to do some kind of practical work, which will be visualizing the density of pubs in London. combining my two favorite topics. So let's have a look at this. So first of all, let's get some pubs data. So how are we going to get some pubs data?
Visit them.
Yeah, that's one of the ways, and then record it, and then probably we'll get a very, very messy data. But actually, that's what I'm trying already for 9 years, and still haven't got there. But the other way is that you just go to OpenStreetMap data. You know, have you heard about OpenStreetMap?
Yeah.
Great. I love OpenStreetMap, and I would call it, say, Wikipedia for maps. And everyone can contribute, and it's really good fun for weird people like me. And the cool thing that you can actually download the back data for them. So all the data that people have recorded, you can just grab it, and it's really available. And there are some utilities which allow you to manipulate this data and extract some other things. So in our case, we'll be just downloading the Greater London. Actually, let me go here and show you how it looks like. So yeah, just if you will need some raw data from. Some data, then you can just go to this website. It's a German website, and they are amazing. And you can actually download, first of all, the whole planet, but you also can download continents, which are quite a big files. Also, you can download each country, and then you can download many, many cities. So in our case, I just found a link for Great Britain, for London. Here we go. And it's 37 megabytes, so I would not suggest you download it here, because it looks like the internet is really slow here. But yeah, just download this file. It's in a binary PDF format. I don't think we need to cover this stuff, but basically it's a collection of points, lines, polygons, and relations. So everything you have recorded to London. You download this thing, and you have a utility called OSM Convert. If you just Google it, you will find all the It has a very, very good manual, and it basically explains you how to do stuff. But basically, you can extract all the amenities from this data set, and you get them in tab-separated format. And basically, what you get is this kind of stuff. And if we have a look, we have 3,491 pubs in London, which is impressive. It will take me another 10 years to edit all of them. First of all, let's do something with that. This is my so-called one-liner, which is a 10-liner, for reading this file. So I'm basically reading all the lines in this file. I'm removing the end of line, I'm splitting this line into columns by tabulator, and then I'm creating a dictionary for each pub, which will have name, which will have coordinates, which will have a shapely point object, and it will have another thing, which is a projection. So I have decided to project things into our local coordinate reference system, where the origin point will be the Finsbury Square. And if you do this, and if we go for the pub, which is, well, this is the ID, I have looked it up. This is the pub called Finch, which is outside just near the Muge station. And it is located 64 meters east from Finsbury Square and 83 meters north from this. So it actually works. So the way you do, actually, this is a magic string. You can use it everywhere. So let's use a stereographic projection. This is the origin. So this is the central point. And these are some extra some extra parameters. So this is actually the radius of Earth. This is the units. We want meters. And if you just define this projection and we project any point to it, then we will, any latitude, longitude to it, then we will get this information, which is coordinates in meters from some given point. Obviously, it will give you huge distortions if you try to work with objects which are hundreds of kilometers from each other. But I think up to 50 kilometers, you will get an accurate enough shape, coordinates. So it's pretty useful. I also would like to say that bear in mind that this executing this statement is really CPU consuming. So it actually generates a function, and it has a lot of different mathematical functions in it. So make sure you try to cache this information.
Does it have to be defined like that as a string, or can you pass an addictive of variables?
You can also define different. So each of these things can define as a separate variable. And I think you just—I mean—it's all described very nicely on the documentation.
Okay.
But I mean, for me, it seems like just putting everything as a string will be much simpler.
It's just the fact that that's very fragile to me.
Oh, right. So. Makes sense. Well, this is a accepted industry standard string, so it's not something that Proj has found out for itself. It's something that it's used in many other places. Okay, so this is one of the pubs, which is located next to you here. Then the next thing, let's load the wards. Okay, you've seen the wards data and QGIS. This is how it looks like. We are located, I think, here somewhere. And if we want to do it very, very simply, so yeah, let's do this, let's load it. Then what we do, we just for each pub, so for each ward, we transform it to a shape object, and then we try to test whether this ward contains a pub. If it does, then we just increment the number of pubs in this ward, and we just add it to the properties of the ward. So if we start running this, this will take really, really, really long time. I mean, this is like 10 seconds, and it's just calculate the first ward. The reason for this is actually because our wards are not simplified. Each ward has more than 1,000 coordinates. And bear in mind that we are going through 3,000 pubs and 630 wards, so it will be around 500,000, or I don't know, iterations. And each of these iterations has to test intersection of 10,000 coordinate shape with a point. So this will take really, really long time. And that's why I would not advise you to do this. So let's stop it, and let's think a different approach. So one of the approaches is that we use some kind of index. So if we could have some magic things which queries us for all the pubs which are within this kind of shape, that will be much, much more useful. And this is how we go. So we introduce the concept of a spatial index. So there are many spatial indexes. And I'm not going to talk about them right now. Actually, you can Google of them. But basically, the index in geospatial world works like a tree. It's a quad tree, and the time of looking up an element of it is a log n, where n is number of elements you have there. So it's really, really fast, I would say so. So what we will do here, we will just insert all the pubs in this tree. And tree is actually designed to store bounding boxes instead of points. But you can actually give some zero area bounding boxes, something like that. So for example, inserting a pub with the same, like with double coordinates is fine. So if you run it, it runs really, really fast. And then for each ward, we will be testing. We will be asking to give us all the pubs which are within this boundary. And if we will run this thing, this will be much, much, much faster. It still takes some time to execute it. So it's still executing, but this is much, much, much faster. So what it does for each ward, it just finds. So obviously, a tree. It's not a magical thing. So it cannot really retrieve you. Points which are within an exact shape, so it stores only rectangles. So that's why we need to give some rectangle as a parameter for it. And then once we retrieve all the pubs which are within this rectangle, we still have to test the intersection. But this is a very small subset of pubs which actually match this thing. So it will go really, really fast. So we still have to do this kind of costly operation, but on a much smaller amount of things. So yeah, if we just... Sorry?
change your mind.
Oh.
Okay, I will be finishing very, very soon. So yeah, once we add it to the properties, and remember that GeoJSON stores features and not geometries, we just save it. And we save it using just simple JSON operator. And then we have this data, which is the rewards with pubs. And we just go to QGIS and find this data. Here we go. Now, each of these things has a new feature, a new attribute called pub count. Let me see. Yeah, here we go. For example, Westminster has 111 counts. And QGIS has a very nice way of formatting the thing. So let's color the wards according to the number of pubs in it. So I'm going to use pub count as a thing. Here we go. So it looks like most of the pubs are located in these things, and everything else is really red. And this is because we have look at this distribution. So everything which has less than 31 pubs is red. And if you want to do some kind of equal equal count of each category, then we can do this in QGIS very simply. And now it's much better. But this still kind of a wrong information, because number of pubs also can correlate with the area of the ward. So I would say that we have to do this kind of graph based on number of pubs per hectare. So I have included this property as well. So if we do different column. Right, I need to regenerate this data. There we go. This will be like a pub density in London, which is, I don't know whether it's useful or not. I like it. Obviously, you still have to make sure that the data is correct. So in our case, I think this is Orpington. And it has only one pub, which is not true. It has at least three of those. It's true that it has only one decent pub, but so just make sure that the original data set is correct, and in some cases it's not correct. So in our case, I think someone urgently has to go to Orpington, check all those pubs, and add them to OpenStreetMap just to make it all accurate. So I think this is it from my side. Thank you very much, and I will put some tutorial on how to install things over this weekend. Thank you very much. Thank you.